sound of revival. Let heaven roar, let fire fall. Come shake the ground with the sound of revival.
Eternity, free forever. you, Jesus, for all you have done.
Good morning, everybody. Why don't you just take a moment and greet somebody this morning? Tell them welcome to Lighthouse Church. Folks are late getting in today. Hey. Hey. All right. I'd like to welcome those who are watching online this morning. Glad you're here. A lot of you on vacation, or you're out, you're camping, or maybe you're Edie at the rehab center in the hospital. Glad you're watching today. Kids are coming in for just a minute. You could be seated. So today is our promotion Sunday. School starts this Thursday. And all the kids said, no, they're not excited about that. Let's try the parents. School starts on Thursday, and all the parents said, yeah, yeah. Exactly my sentiments. So this is Promotion Sunday today, and I'm going to ask Blair to come up, and I'm going to ask for, who's our children's? Oh, there she is right there. Alexis, our children's pastor. I'm going to turn over to Alexis.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. So, today is a sad day for me, happy day for Blair. I am promoting a bunch of my kids. Some of them are not here, but I'd like to honor them anyways. So these are students who are going into sixth grade this week for school, meaning they have graduated out of Children's Church and now get to sit upstairs with you guys in what we call Big Church. And be a part of youth group on Friday nights, and I believe you're having a potluck this, this Friday, right, for all the new kids coming and their families. So they'll get to join in, see what youth group is all about for the first time, and then continue to be a part of that during the fall and all the way through until they graduate out of youth group. So without further ado, I'd like to honor some of our kids that are here and not here. I have a certificate for them and a box of candy. We're giving them Sour Patch Kids today because I have a sour feeling about them leaving Children's Church, but they are going to have a sweet time with Blair. So one of our first ones is Sophie Hansen. I don't believe she is here, but we'll honor her and give her a round of applause anyways. Also, Hannah Desimone, who could not be with us today. We'll honor her anyways. And if Casey Vega could come on up to the stage. She has not been a part of Lighthouse Kids for very long, but the time that she has been here has been an absolute pleasure, and I'm so excited to see her grow. Here you go, Casey. Also like to honor Danielle DeMars. She's been here a short amount of time as well. She wasn't able to make it today, but we'll give her a round of applause for moving on up. As well as Stephen Brown, who has been attending youth group, but not officially moved out of Children's Church yet. So he will officially move out and join you guys up here on Sundays. And is Sebastian here? I thought I saw him downstairs. Come on up, Sebastian. Sebastian has also stayed downstairs with us for an extra year, which has been an absolute pleasure. He's a great leader, and I'm so excited to see what God has to do in his life. There you go, Sebastian. And another one of our girls is Princess Nayamiche, and she was not able to make it today, but she will also be moving up, and She's going to be a great addition to youth group as well. And Levi Sherman as well. I don't see him here. I think they are on vacation, but we'll honor him as well moving into youth group. And if Caleb Perry would come and join us on the stage. Caleb is our fun one of the bunch. He's going to bring a lot of laughter to youth group, so he's going to have a great time, and we're so excited to see what God has in store for you. And finally, if Bailey Rosinski could come on up. Bailey has been a great leader downstairs, a great helper to me, always willing to serve wherever there is help needed, and I can't wait to see what God's going to do with her life as she continues to grow. Although some of our kids were not able to make it, we have, if you counted, a total of 11 of my children's church kiddos that are moving into youth group, so that's a big change for our dynamic downstairs, but keep them in your prayers. They're going to be watching you to see what it's like to be upstairs, observing the difference between kids' church and big church. And so I'm just excited to see what God has in store for them and what he has in store for the kids' ministry going forward. Thank you.
We are also very excited to have them upstairs and worship with us. And thank you for preparing them. Preparing them and their growth and maturity. And we have asked all the kids to come up. In fact, if you're going to school in the next week, whether it's elementary school, kindergarten, preschool, high school, college, graduate school, and you would like prayer, we're going to ask you to come and join us in the front. I'm going to ask all the kids to line up across the front, if you would. Just a single file line all across here. If you guys, you give them instructions. Yeah. All right. Actually, I guess I need that. Peter. Thank you. Yeah. Where's our other high schoolers? And come on up. Yeah. Just make a single file all the way across the front. Just spread out down here, Charlie. Thank you. All the way across the front. All right. This is important. You know, our kids have faced a lot of opposition at school because of their faith. I'm going to talk a little bit about that in my message this morning, but it's a different world we live in today. It's a post-Christian era. And these young men and women are children of God. And so they are light going into a dark place, and they need our prayers. So I'm going to ask for all of the parents, if you have a child up here, will you come and stand behind them? Yeah. And Blair and I have been talking about this, you know, and praying about this. This is an important prayer, and I've asked him to lead us in this prayer today. And we're going to ask the rest of the congregation, if you would, just to stand up in reverence. And if you will just extend your hand this way towards our children this morning as we pray. Will you extend your hand this way this morning as Blair leads us in prayer?
Lord, the world continues to change, and it will continue to change, Lord. I look out, Lord, and I see so many young people, Lord, that are going through elementary school, middle school, high school, college, God. And it doesn't get easier as an increasingly secular world, an increasingly hateful world, an increasingly confusing and cruel world teachers and principals and students, Lord, will continue to throw ideas and throw confusion and biblical perversions at these students, Lord. And I just want to pray a hedge of protection over them, Lord. I pray that Lighthouse Church would become that protection for them, Lord, that this would become a safe space to ask the questions, Lord, to live out their faith, Lord. I pray a special anointing over each and every student in this row and each and every parent standing behind them, Lord, that the laying on of hands would become not just a back-to-school tradition, Lord, but parents would be continually pushed to lay hands, continuously praying for their children, praying for their hearts, praying for them to guide their friends to our Lord and Savior. Jesus, you are love, and you came to bring love. You came to bring peace, Lord. So I pray peace over their hearts as they all go forward, Lord. I pray a fearless faith, and I pray just a relentless love, Lord. I pray for fervent knowledge, Lord. I pray for them to just seek after you before they're seeking after any other thing in this world, before they seek after friend groups, before they seek after sporting events, Lord. I just pray, Lord, that this would be a home for them to chase you, to seek after you, Lord. And I pray for the parents, Lord, to bring them up in homes that would nurture them and that would grow them in wisdom, in maturity, in faith, in love, Lord. I pray for hearts for the outside people, the people outside their church that are unsaved, Lord, that this generation can really turn this around and really take Plainfield, take Eastern Connecticut, take Connecticut, and take New England for God, Lord.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
That this is more than just my dream. This is more than just pastor's dream. This is more than just something that we can do, Lord. It is something that only you can accomplish through your will, Lord God. And I pray for big things for every young person standing in front of me and for every parent behind them, Lord. Anoint them, Lord. Keep them strong, Lord. And pray for a faith that only you can give, Lord, and help them to pray for things that only you can deliver. And I pray all these things in the almighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Yeah. Amen. Listen, every one of you young people, look at me. Look at me for just a minute before you go back to your chairs. Please look at me. Listen. God has great plans for you. You are world changers. You are going to make a difference, not just in your school, but in this whole region. God is going to use you in a mighty way. Don't be afraid. And also, I want to say, for you to look around, there are hundreds of people literally promising. You promise that you will. We are praying for you every single day. You are not alone. You have your church family, you have your family, and you have your pastor praying for you every day. And you are going to do great things for God. God bless you. Love one another as you go. Thank you. Let's remain standing now. Let's go into worship. Let's remain standing and let's pray to the Lord today.
Psalm 115. Not to us, Lord, not to us, but to your name be the glory, because of your love and faithfulness. Why do the nations say, "Where is their God?" Our God is in heaven. He does whatever pleases him. But their idols are silver and gold made by human hands. They have mouths but cannot speak, eyes but cannot see. They have ears but cannot hear, noses but cannot smell. They have hands but cannot feel, feet but cannot walk. Nor can they utter a sound with their throats. Those who make them will be like them. So will all those who trust in them. That's saying that when we make idols, we become like them. Whatever we want, whatever we receive praise or give praise to, we become like those idols. But God has called us not to have any idols, but not to us, Lord, not to us, but you be the glory. Your praise will always be on our lips, Lord. We give you the glory. Lord, I pray that none of us would get it but you. You're the only one deserving of it. In our circumstances, our lives are ebb and flow, up and down all the time. But God, he remains faithful and steadfast throughout 1,000 generations. Amen.
hands devoted, like a ring of solid gold, like a vow that is tested, like a covenant of old. Your love is enduring through the winter rain and beyond the horizon, with mercy for today. Faithful you have been, and faithful you will be. You pledge yourself to me, and it's why I sing. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on. Your kindness makes us whole, and you shoulder our weakness, and your strength becomes our own. You're making me like you, you're clothing me in white, bringing beauty from ashes, for you will have your bride. Of all her guilt and rid of all her shame and known by her true name. And it's why I sing. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips.
Are you Lord? And you will be praised.
Completely to you.
interrupt a worship service, but let me tell you,
Ephesians 6:14, stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth and having put on the breastplate of righteousness and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace, in all circumstances take up the shield of faith, which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints. The Bible says, and having done all, to stand firm. Having done all, everything that you've prayed and fasted, and having done all, you're not called to sit. We're called to stand on the word of God, because he declares what is truth. He is not a man that he cannot lie. His, what he says goes, his will is will be done in your life, in this house, in this body. The body, the enemy has no right, no legal right to stand here, because the saints stand here. We stand on the word of God.
With arms high and heart open.
Let's declare that in the presence of the Lord.
Of the one who
arms high and heart abandoned in all. Jesus.
To take up too much time, but Isaiah 65:8, thus says the Lord, as the new wine is found in the cluster, and they say, do not destroy it, for there is still good in it, so I will do for my servant's sake and not destroy them all. New wine is found in the cluster. So we have a cluster of grapes, which is Israel, and there's some bad grapes in there. The Lord says he's not going to destroy all of it because the new wine is found in the whole thing. The whole thing. And there's some people in here right now that don't think that they're going to be used by God because something bad that they did. Just as Israel is made up, a nation is made up of many people, so our lives is made up of many moments, many decisions. And there might be some bad grapes, bad decisions, but the Lord says, just as they say, don't destroy it, for there's still good in it, there's still good in you. He still has a call and a purpose for your life. The gifts and callings of God are without repentance, which means he created you with a purpose, and you just have to walk in it. He doesn't take it away. The enemy takes away your confidence to walk in it, but he can't take away your identity because it's who you are and it's who God created you to be. So there's still good in it. There's still good in you. There's still good in all of it because he is good, and he created you in his image. He has redeemed you. Just as there's new wine found in the cluster, there's still good. There's still a blessing in it. He can still use it. He works all things together for the good who love God and are called according to his purpose. So as we sing the song, this song is a song of surrender to make me an offering, make me whatever you want me to be. But just like there's new wine that needs to be poured into new wineskins that Jesus talks about, we need a new mind, we need a new heart to be able to handle what God has for us. We can't keep walking in the same ways that we've been walking. We can't be thinking and feeling the same ways we've been thinking and feeling. We need to step into his destiny for us and his calling for us, because there's no room. There's no room for the old ways. There's no room for the old styles of thinking and just in the past. It takes up so much space in our minds and our hearts, the past. We must move forward. So if this song is for you, if the Lord is speaking to you, if he's using me to talk to you, just surrender to him. He makes all things new. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. He can't lie. You become one. Lord, we offer ourselves to you right now in this season, in this moment. We ask that you give us a new heart, refresh our hearts, refresh our minds, God. It's been a long season. It's been a long season, and some of us are really tired. But God, you make all things new. We ask for your heart and your mind. In your name, Jesus, amen.
In the crushing, in the pressing, you are making new wine. In the soil I now surrender, you are breaking new ground. So I yield to you into your careful hand. When I trust you, I don't need to understand. So make me a vessel, make me an offering, make me whatever you want me to be. God, I came here with nothing, but all you have given me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Crushing, in the pressing, You are making new wine right here and right now. Oh, in the soil I now surrender. You are breaking new ground. Oh, yes, you are. You are breaking new ground. So make me a vessel and make me an offering. Make me whatever you want me to be. God, I came here with nothing but declaration this morning, and Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Oh, Jesus, bring new wine out. Oh, say it again. Jesus, bring new wine out. We declare it in your name, Jesus. Jesus, bring new wine. Jesus, bring new wine.
Those words, church.
Power to save.
The song starts off with in the crushing, in the pressing, there's new wine. Some of us today are feeling crushed, some of us are feeling pressed. I encourage you, though, that God is creating a new thing out of that. God uses that crushing, that pressing, to make that new wine. It can't be done otherwise. Sometimes we hold so tightly to things in our lives and we don't want to let go. They define us, the things that we do. They define us, the things that we own. And when God asks us to give them up and to lay them down, it can feel like a crushing. You're not going to reach that next level. He's not going to be able to do what he wants to do in you until you let it go, and unless you let it go. And some of us, we feel stuck. We've gotten to a certain level. We've gotten so far, and we can't seem to press on to that next level. What are you holding on to? Because that's what God wants to crush. That's what God wants to press, to create new wine. Seated today as we prepare for our offering. We're going to ask you all to give the common 40% that God requires. But what if he did? Think about that for a minute, though. What if God did ask for 40% instead of the 10% of a tithe? Are we holding on to it so tightly that we wouldn't be able to give it up? We've sung a couple songs that talk about how everything we have is because the Lord has given it to us. We came here with nothing. We're leaving with nothing outside of the souls that God uses us to bring to him. That's the reward. It's the only thing you can take with you. Outside of that, you leave with nothing. And there have been people who God has asked for their entire paycheck. What if he were to ask you for your whole paycheck this week? And he just says, put it in. And I'm not trying to guilt anybody into this or say or even imply that that's what he's doing. But examine the condition of your heart, because the moment if we're holding on to it, we're going to be resistant to that. If we're fully giving ourselves over to the Lord, we know that everything is his. We trust in him completely. He's going to take care of us no matter what. So if he says, give the whole paycheck, John, John's going to give the whole paycheck, because he knows who holds his present and who holds his future. And he knows that that might be a crushing, but God's going to reveal something to him in that. God's going to use that to bless others. And if you're someone who faithfully tithes but hasn't been downstairs recently, I encourage you to go downstairs. Because your tithes have been used to bring ministry to this place, to make this a sanctuary, to build God's house, and to build God's house outside of these four walls. That's what we're tithing for. There's a practical application of that. God only asks for the 10%. And the practical application is we have lights. We're not playing acoustic unless it's by choice. You have seats. It's temperature controlled in here for the most part. And that's because we give. People are brought in. We have ministries that are birthed and people that are reaching out to others because we give. God held nothing back from us. He gave us everything. everything. He poured out all of heaven. And the truth is that that's exactly what he requires from you too. He only asks for 10% of your money, your income, but he requires all of you. That's the exchange that we have. So God, we just ask that you would bless this offering right now, that it would be used to further your kingdom, Lord, that it would be used for your good purposes. God, we ask that it would be pleasing to you, that we would bring it before you with glad hearts, Lord, because you enjoy a cheerful giver and not one who gives grudgingly, Lord. And for those who may be giving out of their own need and necessity, Lord, like the woman with the 2 pence, Lord, God, I ask that you would just bless them, that in this time of crushing, Lord, that you would bring that new wine and you would do so quickly, God. God, that you would show them the next step, that you would bring them to that next level, God. And God, as we symbolically give 10% of our income, we lay down 100% of our hearts, God. We bring all of ourselves to you. And we ask that we ourselves become an offering to you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
So make me your vessel. Make me an offering. Make me whatever you want me to be. God, I came here with nothing, but all you have given me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Oh, Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Yes, Jesus, bring new wine out of me.
That's exactly what's taking place today. Let's just keep playing for a minute. Some of you are new to our church, and you say, what's going on? People crying, people getting emotional. You know, God is doing a work in people's lives that's supernatural. You can't even explain it. Putting in new wine, restoring, healing. I've learned, I've been pastoring for over 35 years, and I can tell you that God can, we can pray for a person, for a situation, day in, day out, month after month, year after year, and see nothing happen. And in a service like this, somebody surrender to God, and God just answer that prayer and change their heart in like 10 seconds. That's the power of the Holy Spirit. And that's what we're about, what Christ can do. And he's here this morning. He's working. He's changing. He's transforming. He's healing. He's restoring. He's pouring that new wine. Some of you, your glass is really empty. And as you just open your arms like a sign of surrender, say, God, I surrender. I'm empty. I have nothing to give you. I just give you myself. And that's what he wants. That's what he wants. And when you do, he just pours in. He just pours in all that you need. Isn't he a good God? He's a good God. He's a good God. Father, I thank you today for the work of your Holy Spirit. I do not want to even try and preach without the anointing of your Holy Spirit. I don't want to have a service. We don't want to sing. We don't want to do anything without the anointing of your Holy Spirit, because it's the anointing that makes the difference. It breaks the yokes of bondage, that sets people free. And I thank you for the people who have been set free today, who have been healed and delivered already, and we're only halfway through the service. And I thank you, Lord, that you have more that you're going to do through your word, because as the Bible says, he sent forth his word and healed them. So as your word goes forth, I pray that it would do 2 things. You said in Hebrews 4, my word, you said the word of God is like a two-edged sword, that it goes in, it cuts us. Sometimes the Holy Spirit convicts us of sin, work cut to our heart about things in our life that are hindering us in our relationship with God or others. The same sword that cuts heals. It's two-sided. And you never cut us without healing us. You cut out sin. You cut out the cancer of sin in us. And then you heal us. And that sword that divides heals, restores, empowers. And I pray you would do that in this service. I pray that through your word this morning that you would cut us and that you would heal us. And that you would do the work that you have accomplished for this day to perform in Jesus' name. If you agree with me in that, say amen. 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 Thank you. Thank you. I want you to get your Bibles, open your Bible apps this morning. I'm going to read several passages of Scripture today. I want to talk to you this morning about knowing God. I want to talk to you about knowing God. And the simple premise of the message is this. There's a lot of people who know about God, but not a lot of people who really know God. You know, you can know all about Jesus and not know him. You can know all about Jesus but have not experienced him. You can know all about church and religion, and you can quote scriptures till it's coming out of your ears and never experience the presence and power of Christ in your life. And so if you're looking at me like, what are you talking about? But the truth is, I find that to be the issue with a lot of people and a lot of Christians today. So I want to tell you this morning that you can know God. You can experience God. God is a person that wants to have a relationship with us. And for those of you who have been Christians for a long time, I want you to know that you have not arrived and that there is so much of God that you don't know about that he wants to reveal to you. There's more. There's more. Amen? So stand with me and turn to John, the Gospel of John, chapter 17. And for those of you who have Bible apps, I'm sorry. Sometimes I use a Bible app, and it's great for reading a passage of Scripture, but when you're like jumping back and forth, you have to, do all this. So just hang with me best you can. John chapter 17, verse 3. In the context here, Jesus is praying for himself. And he talks to his Father. And in verse 3, he says, "Now this is eternal life, that they," and "they" is speaking of his disciples, those who follow him. So he's talking about you. "That they may know you." Jesus' prayer is that we would know God, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. This is the prayer of Jesus. He says, "I want all of my followers to know you, Father, and to know me." Now, the Greek word that is used here is the word gnosko. And there are different words in the Greek for know or knowledge. And this is not the word that is used for intellectual knowledge. It is a word that means experiential knowing. That you know something not because you read about it, but you know because you have experienced it. Amen. You know what it's like. That's the Greek word that is used here. Jesus is not saying, I want people to know about you. He's saying, I want people to experience you. You getting that? Amen. Now let's turn over to Philippians chapter 3. In Philippians chapter 3, the Apostle Paul is writing a letter to the church at Philippi. This is a prison epistle. It was written as perhaps the last letter that he would write before he was executed and beheaded in Rome. And he writes to the church these powerful words. And let's begin verse 7, chapter 3, verse 7. "Whatsoever was to my profit, And he's talking about all the things that he had accomplished in his life. All the degrees he had, all his training, all his pedigree. He says, all of these, whatever was to my profit, I now consider them loss for the sake of Christ. In other words, all that means nothing to me. The only thing that matters to me is that I know Jesus. What is more, I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus. Now think about this. The Apostle Paul was not alive when Jesus was walking on the earth. And yet he talks here about the greatest thing in his life is that he has been able to know Jesus Christ. And he says, my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. And lost means I have given them up. I consider them rubbish. And the Greek word that is used here is a word that is used for when you take, when they would use the bathroom and their excrement and they would take it to the dunghill. That was the where the stuff went. That's the extreme word he uses. All of that in my life compared to knowing Christ is like dung. This is what I want, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of mine own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ and righteousness that comes from God and is by faith. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of sharing in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow to attain to the resurrection from the dead. Think about that. All that Paul had done with the Lord, all the great experiences he had had with Christ, and this cry at the end of his life is, if you think, if anybody ever knew Jesus, if anybody experienced Jesus, it was the Apostle Paul. And yet he says, I want to know him. Why? Because once you've tasted of the things of God, you want more. You want more. Matthew chapter 7. Go back to the gospel. First gospel in the New Testament, Matthew chapter 7. Jesus here is teaching in the Sermon on the Mount. Verse 7. You know these verses well. Ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and the door will be opened to you. For everyone, say everyone. Everyone who asks, receives. He who seeks, finds. And to him who knows, knocks, the door will be opened. And in context here, Jesus is talking not about material things. He is talking about spiritual things. And then he gives an example. Which of you, if his son asked for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks you for a fish, will you give him a snake? If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give good gifts to those who ask him? Jesus is telling us in red letters, God desires to give you his Holy Spirit. He wants you to know him. One more verse, 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter, towards the end of the New Testament. 1 Peter chapter 2. Verse 2. And I already know I'm not probably going to get halfway through this message. I'm just going to take my time here. We'll finish next week. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 2. He says, like newborn babies crave pure spiritual milk, you should crave pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow up in your salvation, now that you have tasted that the Lord is good. The simple message from Peter to his audience and to us is this. When you are born again, when you come into Christ and you experience Him, when you have new life, that's just the beginning. There is so much more for you. That we are start our journey with Christ like little babies, and we can grow into maturity. Turn to your neighbor and say, there's more. And you can be seated. You can be seated. God bless you. Two things have been on my heart all week, and I'm just going to talk to you as your pastor this morning, like from my heart, okay? Some pastoral stuff. We in our deacon's meeting last Sunday, I was asking the deacon board, I asked them this question, do you feel like our summer, Lighthouse Love summer campaign has worked? And the goal of our summer campaign was to do things, you know, after church and off campus so that the people in our church would spend time getting to know each other. That people who feel disconnected from the church would feel more connected to the church. Because I shared with you how our church does so many things right, but I don't feel like we can get to the next level until we really learn how to get people plugged in, that we need to get to know each other. There's people that come to church here for months and even years and don't even know people sitting on the other side of the church. You say, well, there's too many people here. But we can be relational. And so we don't try. So the deacon board told me, they said, in essence, they said, no, we don't think it's worked. We still have people that are just like sitting out of church or disconnected or say, you know, I just feel disconnected. I feel out of fellowship. I don't feel like I'm part of what's going on. They just kind of fade out of the scene. You see them here, you know, and all of a sudden, 3-4 weeks later, where's so-and-so? I don't know. Where have they been? I don't know. Well, they're just disconnected, and nobody's calling them. Nobody's saying, hey, where were you? You're gone, you know, last Sunday. I missed you. There's none of that. You know, there's very little of that that's going on in our church. We're trying to solve that issue. We want to make it better. And so we started brainstorming, what can we do to fix this in our church? How can we get people more connected? You know, how can we follow up on people? We could do this. And we're just going around. We just talk. And this went on for like 30 minutes. And then we just kind of stopped. Somebody said something. I don't remember who it was. But somebody just made the point that struck all of us. None of these things are going to work. Because really, it's a symptom of a spiritual issue. A heart that is on fire for Jesus. You can't keep them out of church. A heart that is on fire for Jesus is going to share their love with other people. They're going to want to minister to people. A heart that's on fire for Jesus, we don't have to plod and plead and give gift certificates to get them to teach a class or to help with our children's ministry or work in the nursery or be an usher. They're like the opposite. What can I do? Where can I serve? What we need is more of the Holy Spirit. What we need is a move of God that will melt all of our hearts and take us back to why we are here and what we're about. And you know what? No program's going to do that. No sermon series is going to fix that. What will fix that is what's taking place at the altar this morning. It's the Holy Spirit. And so that has been a great burden on my heart this week.
And the deacon board said, you know what? We are going to start fasting every Wednesday. We're not going to say like for the next 3 weeks or 4 weeks. We're just going to fast every Wednesday until we see a move of God in our church. And I want to invite you as the congregation to join us in that fast. If you could take a meal even on Wednesdays and push aside and just pray, God, will you pour out the Holy Spirit on Lighthouse Church so that we will be so passionately in love with you and in love with people. If you would just pray that prayer and fast with us, I believe God will answer. I believe he will. The second thing that's on my heart is an article that I read in Christianity Today. The article is entitled, I didn't write the title down, but I have the article. I'll give you a copy of it if you like it. I sent it to all the leaders in the church to read. And the article is about how pastors, challenges or something that pastors have with the next generation. The next generation coming up is called Generation Z. And, you know, that's the secular term they put on it. I think it could be a spiritual term because I think they're going to be the last generation before Jesus comes back, the end of the alphabet. And Generation Z. And here are statistics that it shared about Generation Z in the article. This year, the kids that are going into kindergarten through third grade will be the first cohort of elementary students where the minority ethnic population is larger than the white population. This is across the board in the United States, which speaks of the change of culture of our country and of our nation. Now, I'm not saying these facts to make a point. I'm just sharing the facts with you. Secondly, this generation is the most unchurched generation, whereas the generation before them knew things about the Bible, who Jesus was. They knew some of the Bible stories, Jonah and the whale, the flood. They've heard that kind of stuff. The new generation that's coming up, not coming up, that is here, all the kids that are downstairs right now that we just laid hands on, guess what? They are the most unchurched, unknowing of God. They don't even know, many of them, the basic Bible stories or even maybe who Jesus is. And of course, we see that we have become a post-Christian America. And that's reflected in so many things. This is a pastor, I've seen it in the last several years. You know, it used to be, for example, just as one example, how this plays out in our church and how it affects the church. It used to be that, you know, Sunday was the day when people went to church, right? So you don't have basketball and soccer and sports events on Sunday, right? Now, it's just another day of the week. There's no thought for school systems or recreation systems. It's like, oh, we have games on Saturdays and Sundays. We have practice on Saturdays and Sundays and Wednesdays. They don't even consider people to go to church because people don't go to church. And so that affects us, doesn't it? That affects us. The new norm for church attendance for Christians, quote unquote, will soon be 1.5 times a month. Think about that. Most people who call themselves Christians in America, you say, well, you know, people in our church, they go twice a week. What do you mean once a... I'm telling you what the norm is out there, outside of these doors. I'm thankful we're not a part of that norm, but this is the world that we live in right now. Those who call themselves Christians and worshipers of God and part of the church and feel that they are a part of a local church will attend church an average of 1.5 times a month. So how does the church impact such a post-Christian culture and an ever-increasing anti-Christian, anti-organized religion culture? Am I telling the truth? Isn't that what we live in? What you face at work every day, what you students face at church, it's no longer like, well, we're not Christian. It's now
anti-Christian. It's now make fun of religious people. It's now put down those who don't believe in evolution, but believe in creation. It's now you're stupid. It's now you're ignorant. It's now you're behind the times. It's now you're uneducated. You think that it's wrong for a man to marry a man or a woman to... What's wrong with you? You're like dinosaur age. And it's anti... And people will not hire us. People will not give us opportunities in the workplace. People will not advance us in educational institutions because of our stand for what we believe. It has become anti-Christian. How are we going to raise our kids in this? How is our church going to take Eastern Connecticut and the Last Green Valley for the gospel with this darkness out there? How's it going to happen? And the only answer I can see is what's presented in the Word of God, that we have got to be more than ever before a church that is on fire with the power of the Holy Ghost. It can't be anymore. Church is normal. That's not gonna get it. It's not gonna get it. Yeah, I go to church on Sundays or I listen to the podcast. Nope, not gonna get it. You're gonna have to have some real Jesus in you. To be able to stand up and be a witness, to be able to make a difference, for your light to be attracted to the darkness that is out there, you're going to have some real light in you. You can't be dim. You're going to have to be blazing. If ever we needed the Holy Spirit, it's now. We're going to have to raise up a generation that is so on fire for Jesus. They can handle persecution. They can handle the stigmatism. They can handle the hatred of Antichrist spirit that is growing in our culture. And not just so they can survive, but we want them to thrive. We want them to thrive. I'm telling you, the day is coming, and you mark my words. This is going on record. This is being recorded. The day is coming very soon when one of two things is going to happen to churches in America. They're going to either cave in to the cultural norms and become institutions for religious thought and humanistic endeavors with zero spiritual power, or they're going to become powerful lights shining in a dark place. Militant churches advancing the kingdom of God against all the spiritual and the political opponents. And that, my friends, is the kind of church that I am leading Lighthouse to become. And the only way to get there is not add programs, or the only way to get there is more of the Holy Spirit. We've got to have more of God. We've got to know God more than we ever have before. We've got to have an experience, not just a head knowledge, but a heart knowledge and a hand knowledge where we know what's in our heart. It's changed us and it affects our hands, how we live, how we walk, how we talk every single day. Amen. That's the kind of knowledge we must have of God. And I can tell right now as I'm preaching this message, that's why there's so much opposition to this word this morning. Because some of you are just so uncomfortable, because the truth is you just want to have so much of Jesus and that's it. Don't mess with my religious experience. Don't challenge me, Pastor. I'm comfortable where I am. Why do I need more of God? I've got exactly what I want right now. And that's exactly why you need more of God. Yeah, I'm glad that you guys are clapping your hands and preaching, but the truth is there'll probably be some people that won't come back to church this morning because of what I just said. And I have to deal with that as a pastor. That's hard, you know? It hurts me. You don't think it hurts my heart when people leave the church? I care for them. I love them. I pray for them every day. You are on my heart. I got to be honest with you. I've got to love Jesus more than I love you.
Amen.
And the more I love Jesus, the more I love you. And what I'm sharing to you this morning may come across kind of harsh or even, I hope not, it may come across to you as bitter. But just know it comes across to you out of the passion and love that I have for Christ. And I know what's coming. I know what's coming. And we're not ready for it. Most of us are not ready for it. I'll be the first to admit, I don't know that I'm ready for it. And I spent a lot more time than normal this week on my face praying for Lane Lavender and not just for you. Because I know that if you're going to have the fire, everything comes from the top down. I've got to have the fire. I've got to have the anointing of the Holy Spirit. I've got to have the hunger for Christ. I've got to model that for you. You've got to see something real and genuine that's taken place in my life. And so I need him just as much as you do. I'm not standing above you this morning. I'm standing beside you. And I'm saying, let's go up to Jesus. That's the way it is. It was for Christians in the early church. See, this is, the Bible is so relevant. In the book of Acts, the church was birthed. Guess what? They were living in a culture that was controlled by Rome, and they were Jews. They were minorities. They were hated to begin with. And now they're followers of this cult, this sect. They called them the Way, the followers of the Way. Eventually, they became called Christians or followers of this Christ, this Jesus guy, because they always used the name of Jesus everywhere they went. But you know what? They persecuted them. Rome persecuted them. They saw Christians as a virus, a plague that was infecting the Roman Empire as it was spreading like a disease. And some of them, like Nero and Diocletian, some of the emperors said, we've got to get rid of these Christians. When Rome burned, Nero saw an opportunity. They blamed it on the Christians so that people would hate Christians for burning Rome. And they did. Christians could not meet in public. People, they had to go in the catacombs where people were, they buried dead bodies. They had to worship in secret places. They had to hide out. They had to have their baptisms in rivers at night where nobody could see them. That was the opposition that they lived in. And you know what? The church was more powerful than ever before then. The church changed the whole world. It spread all around the whole known world and beyond at that time. People's lives were changed, transformed. The persecution, the blood of the martyrs in the church fueled the fire of evangelism. The persecution, the more they persecuted the church, there was a time when the Roman road going into Rome was lined on both sides with crosses, with Christians' rotting fleshes on them. And the more they killed and murdered and the more they persecuted Christians, the stronger the church got. I tell you what, maybe that's what we need. Maybe we need a little more persecution. Maybe what's coming is not such a bad thing for the church. I tell you, I'm all for persecution. If it'll get us more concerned about people knowing Jesus than about our bank accounts or what somebody has said to us on Facebook or what somebody offended me in church. If it takes persecution to get us back centered on Jesus, then bring it. Because there's nothing more important than knowing Christ. It's the only thing that's eternal. It's the only thing that's going to last. Your job, your bank account, your status, all of that is going to burn. But Jesus, the Word of God, eternal life comes to those who serve Him. There's a new world coming. God's going to give us a new earth, and the former is going to be burned. The elements are going to melt with fervent heat, the Bible says. And that's why we have to be passionate on fire. If we don't burn, they will. If we don't burn, they will.
When is it going to be about souls again for us? I'm glad you guys are clapping. The truth is, are people offended by this? I tell you, my spirit is just all torn up this week. And I want you to know this morning that the devil is using every tool he can to distract us. I believe from the time that I was appointed as pastor here and came here, God spoke to me that he was bringing a revival to New England and that Lighthouse was going to be an important part of the move of God in this region. That we were going to be an epicenter for what God was doing in this region around us. And I have seen little glimpses of that, and I've gotten little taste of that, and we have. We felt a little bit of that, and we've seen that. We've had times that all of a sudden a bunch of people were getting saved, and people were getting discipled and plugging into church, and just like the testimonies and the powerful testimonies were going out. And you know what? And you say, and I'm thinking, okay, this is it, you know? This is the beginning of what God is going to do. And I get all excited, and every time it stops. And it always stops, not from anything that's going on the outside of the church. It always stops because of what's going on the inside of the church. We get so distracted by things we think are so important that God could care less about. He could be a diddly about. I'll just be, you know, blunt. Things like social media, Facebook. I am so done with this stuff, you know? People see a post, they hear a post on Facebook. Somebody said this, somebody said, next thing you know, people have left the church over something that's done on Facebook. And you don't even see that the devil is using that to distract you, to distract us from our mission. It's time for us to get off of Facebook and get our face in the book. Right? It really is. It's time for us to really stop and say, God, what is distracting me? Is my work distracting me? Are people distracting me? Is social media distracting me? Is money distracting me? What is it that's distracting me and getting me away from what God is wanting to do in my life and through my church? And that's where we need to start. And that, my friends, is called repentance. It's coming to God and saying, Lord, here I am. I have been distracted. I see it. The pastor spoke it today, and when he spoke it, instantly the Holy Spirit said, pay attention, he's talking to you. And there's things that's distracted me from the calling and passion that I have and has really literally zapped me, just sucked the spiritual life right out of my soul. Lord, will you show me what those things are? Why? So that I can repent of them. So that I can hand them to you and say, God, forgive me. I want to be like the Apostle Paul and say that I might know him and the power of his resurrection, even the fellowship of his suffering, that I might gain some for Christ. That's the power. That's the anointing. That's where it begins. So sometimes, you know, I'm like, as a pastor, I don't want to go through another cycle of this, okay? I don't want to go through another cycle of church growth and then decline, church growth, then decline. Church. In the New Testament, the Holy Spirit poured out. They took the fire of God and went into the world, and they never stopped growing, and they never stopped going. And that's what God wants for all of our churches. I appreciate those who were involved in the Festival of Hope yesterday. And, it wasn't, honestly, it wasn't well promoted. It wasn't well attended at all. But there was a wonderful spirit of unity between the churches that were working there in our community. There was no religious spirit. There was no divisiveness. There was no your church, our church. It was like, we're in this thing together. And that's what we need to see in the local church and in the community, right? That we are, listen, we're on the same team. We're on the same team. We're on God's team. It's not your team and his team and our team. It's God's team. We're on God's team. And we need each other. And we cannot fulfill the great commandment, and we cannot fulfill the great commission alone. And God never intended us to. His purpose was never for us to do anything alone. He's the one that started the church. He's the one that birthed the church. And all the gifts of the Spirit come in the church, through the church. Everything that God's going to do, Ephesians 4 says, everything that God's going to do in these last days, he's going to do through the church. And so it's important that we are together in mission and what God is doing. Can I get a witness to that?
Amen.
And I want to tell you this morning that we can have and experience more of Jesus Christ. We really can. And I haven't even got past the introduction to my message. Will the musicians come? But I feel like that's a good place to stop. And next week, I'm going to tell you, scripturally, I'm going to tell you, I'm going to prove to you from the Bible that God is a God who is personal. He reveals himself to us in terms of personhood. And he wants to have a relationship with us. And then I'm going to show you in the scripture men and women of God who had a personal relationship with God, were even called friends of God. And then I'm going to show you from the scripture how we can get to know God more. How all of us, no matter where you're at in your relationship with God, that you can experience more of Christ. Stand with me right now. But right now, I just feel like I need to make a call for prayer this morning. And here's the first call I want to make. If you'll bow your heads with me this morning, please. A lot of people know about God, but haven't experienced him. I could tell you all about LeBron James. I could tell you about his statistics and who he played and what his history was, what his style is. I could tell you all about LeBron James. I could have posters of LeBron James all over my room. I could wear the clothes with his number on it, his name on my back, and say, I am a fan of LeBron James. But if you ask LeBron James, who is Lane Lavender, he'd say, what? Never heard of Lane Lavender. Now, that's the way a lot of us are with Christ. Let's be honest with ourselves this morning. Just be honest with yourself. Do you just know about Jesus, or have you experienced him? Has he transformed and changed your life so that you could say, you know what? That day, that night, I surrendered and I met Jesus, and my life has never been the same since. If you can't say that, today is your day. Today is your day. Because knowing about Jesus is not going to get you into heaven. Putting your name on a church roll, going through the classes is not going to get you into heaven. Being baptized in the name of a church is not going to get you into heaven. Well, what are you talking about? Can you prove that in Scripture? Absolutely. Jesus said, speaking of Judgment Day, he said, many will come, not a few, many will come on that day to me and say, we cast out demons in your name. We healed the sick in your, we performed miracles in your name. And I will say to them, depart from me, I never knew you. You know what the Greek word that is used there? Gnosko. It's not enough to have the intellectual or head knowledge of Jesus. You've got to experience him. How do I experience Jesus? You come with a repentant heart and acknowledge, I need Jesus. You ask. Jesus said, ask, you receive. Seek, you'll find. Knock, the door will be open to you. It's that simple, but it's a heart thing. It's not a head thing. Yes, with my mind, I'm enlightened. Illumination takes place. Truth comes to my mind, and I see that Jesus is the Son of God, that he really did come, that he really did rise from the dead, that he really is the way, the truth, and the life. That takes place in my head and my heart. I say, I need Jesus. I'm a sinner. I can't change myself. I need him to change me. I want to know him. I want to have a relationship with him. And so I confess with my mouth. I believe in my heart. I confess with my mouth. Jesus, you are the Lord of my life. You have risen from the dead, and I need that resurrection power to resurrect me from my death of sin and give me eternal life. And you surrender fully to him, and you let his Holy Spirit come inside of you and transform you, and you become a new person. And it's the greatest thing you've ever experienced in your life. You know that your sins have been forgiven, that you have a new opportunity, that you're going to live forever, and that you have a new reason for living. It's Jesus. If I'm talking to you this morning, everybody, please, your head bowed. Saints, pray right now. Pray right now. And you be honest with yourself this morning and with God and say, you know what? The truth is, Pastor Lane, I know all about Jesus, but I've never had the experience of Christ that you're talking about. And I want to know him today. I want to know him. I want to experience the power of Christ that you're talking about. If that's you, I'm not going to ask you to raise your hands. Nobody's looking. I'm going to ask you to do this. I'm going to ask you to publicly make a profession before God and the whole world this morning that you are going to be a follower of Jesus Christ, that nothing else is going to matter to you right now in this moment than getting Jesus, than having Jesus in your boat, having Jesus in your heart, experiencing his love, his grace, his forgiveness, his acceptance. That matters more than what anybody would think, more than what anybody would say. I'm going to ask you, if that's you, just to get out of your chair right now, get out of your place wherever you are, and just walk down an aisle and kneel, if you physically can kneel, at the altar as a sign saying, I surrender. Here I am. Here I am, Jesus. I surrender my life to you. Is there anybody here this morning who said, that's me, that's me? There's one. Is there another? Is there somebody else? This is your time right now. This is your time. This is your time right now. This is your time right now.
Down on my knees again, surrendering.
I want to experience Jesus.
Surrendering.
Clap your hands for those who came forward. Come on. We are so happy that Jesus is real for you today.
Lord,
now I'm going to ask my A team, my altar team, to come down and pray with these that have come this morning. Make sure that somebody has somebody to pray with them. Make sure nobody's here praying by themselves. Please. Thank you. Now we're not done. I'm going to give another altar call this morning. If you're here and you say, Pastor, I hear what you said this morning, and I need God to search my heart this morning. I've been distracted. I've let the devil distract me from the main thing. and I'm majoring on minors, and my heart, my passion is messed up. I'm confused. I don't know what to do. I'm in a mess. I just need more of Jesus. I just need to get back my focus on Jesus Christ. If that's you, I ask you to leave your chair and come down this morning and seek the Lord. Seek the Lord. He said, you'll find me when you seek me with your whole heart. Will you come this morning? Jesus, I need to get things together. I need you to examine. I need you to show me things in my heart. I need you to show me the things that the enemy is using to distract me so that I can get back on focus. I can get back on track. Lord, I just come this morning. I just come. Just search me. Are you willing to do that? Holy Spirit, just search me this morning. Just search me. Search my heart. Do I need to get off of social media? Do I need to stop watching those movies? Do I need to stop going to the bar? Do I need to stop being involved with this person who's always gossiping and saying negative things? Are there people in my life that I need to separate myself from right now, Lord? Just search me, show me. Come on, just pray that prayer with me. Just pray that prayer with me. Lord, search my heart today. And those of you who want more of the fire of God's Holy Spirit, will you come and seek Him? Will you come and say, I want more of your Holy Spirit. I want more of your fire. I want more of your anointing. I want more of your power. Will you come this morning? Will you come? I'm not coming back to the pulpit. I'm going to go down here and pray and ask God for more of the Holy Spirit. If you need to leave, you can leave. You're dismissed. There's prayer at 6 o'clock tonight. I hope you come back for prayer. But everybody who can, who is hungry, will you come? And let's seek the Lord. Let's seek Him while He may be found. Let's call upon Him while He is near. Let's ask Him for revival. In Jesus' name.
Like a rushing wind, Jesus, breathe within. Lord, have Your way. Lord, have Your way. Lead me. Like a mighty storm, stir within my soul. Lord, have Your way. Lord, have Your way. Lead me. Like a rushing wind, Jesus, breathe within. Lord, have Your way. Lord, have Your way. Lead me. Like a mighty storm, stir within my soul. Lord, have Your way. Lord, have Your way. Lead me. I surrender. I surrender. I want to know.